get your motor running. Head out on the highway, looking for adventure. And whatever comes our way, yeah, darling, go make it happen. Take the world in a loving place. Fire all of your guns and pumps and explode into space. I like smoking lightning, heavy metal thunder, racing with the wind. Yeah, darling, go make it happen. Take the world in a loving embrace. Fire all of your guns and button. Explode into space. Like a true nature's child, we were born, born to be wild. We can climb so high, I never wanna die.
Hiya, Ben. How's it going, man?
All right, Tino. Hello. Good to see you again. How's things?
Oh, still hanging all in the right direction, buddy.
That's the main thing. You don't want to hang in any other direction.
Definitely not. It's more painful.
Yeah. Oh, it's nice to be back on the TKX-Files.
Yeah.
Didn't expect to be back so soon. There's been an update, I know.
Yeah, I thought I'd have to call this emergency broadcast for everyone's attention. So, tell us, what has happened, Ben? Something has happened.
Well, yeah, I mean,
have you been a bad boy again?
It looks like I am potentially going to be a bad boy. And this is, I think we're living in the era of pre-crime, if you've ever seen Minority Report. And
guilty without charge.
Yeah, someone's got one of those little wooden balls and written my name on it, you know. but that's it, yeah, I mean, we're in a strange... And, I mean, it's this very, very strange situation because, I mean, it looks like, you know, the rot that has been caused but within our community,
yeah,
which we talked about on the previous show, seems to have sunk much deeper than I thought and is affecting more people than I thought. This is not what I really didn't expect this to happen. But it's basically I've been banned from a conference, and this is a completely new experience for me. I've never been banned from a conference before.
Yeah, you're clearly a bad man, Ben. A bad man.
Well, I mean, every conference I go to, I meet people, I get on well with them. If I have arguments, they tend to be good-natured. No one's ever had any problem with my conduct at a conference ever before. In fact, some people say, you know, I could be the life and soul of the event sometimes when I'm in a mood, because I get, if anything, I get a bit hyper and a bit manic at conferences. I'm more exuberant than normal.
Yes, you do tend to get excited. I can bear witness to that.
Exactly. In fact, I go into a bit of a manic depressive phase because at the end of the conference, end of a really good conference, not so much the one-day ones, but the weekend ones, I can actually go into a bit of a sudden brief depression because it's all over.
Back to reality.
So, you know, I'd never thought anyone would be concerned with my presence at a conference. I really didn't, but apparently they are. And this is some.
So tell us which conference it is.
It's the first ever Outer Limits Magazine conference. It's going to take place in Hull on September the 9th. I'm not going to discourage people from going. I'm not saying if you don't not go just because of this. I mean, you may enjoy it. You may learn something. And so if you do go, enjoy it. I don't want to get into some sort of bitter vendetta against this conference. I mean, I am annoyed. I'm upset by it, but I wouldn't want to draw this to a point where it becomes some kind of nasty vendetta. We've had enough of those.
Agreed.
And
yeah.
I want to be dignified about this. That's what I'm saying.
Do you want to run us through the details then? Where did the banning order come from?
Well, just soon after I purchased the ticket. I mean, I heard about this a long time ago, and I planned to go, and I wrote on my website that I planned to go to it. And this was after Sasha Christie published an article in Outer Limits magazine in issue 6. It was an unusual kind of article. Now, what it was, I'll just find the details. Hang on a minute. Because I have got the details of what actually happened here. She published and wrote an article for this magazine called Outer Limits Magazine, and it's issue 6. It's quite a new magazine. It's a free download type mag. She basically, in a single magazine article, she condensed all the various supposed evidence that she gathered against Larry Warren in a tone and a style that was very different to the one she uses on her blog. On her website, she employs, as I've explained before, and I've actually said it in my own articles which I've written about what she's written, she uses a lot of rhetoric. There's a lot of anger in there. She's been unpleasant to him and to me and to you as well and to many other people. This was a professionally written article. It's called The UFO Truth, The Whole UFO Truth, and Nothing But The Truth, which didn't have one of her usual puns, which was unusual.
Yeah.
But it's just basically, it's a pre-CFO project, and she pins the reader's hopes totally on the mainmast of her current project, which is includes things we've talked about before, like her upcoming book, The Warranty Commission, and the £600 which she's going to spend on this analysis of Larry's handwriting, which, for reasons we talked about before, is unlikely to be successful. That's basically the summary of the article. And that's it. There's a couple of other pages. There's contributions by other people within this. There's a whole, like, bumper. It's like a bumper issue with a segment called the Rendlesham Rumpus. Larry's not in it, though. Larry's not there.
Yeah, I believe there was a point that Larry hadn't been given a little right of reply to one of the articles, where there was a few others who were allowed to make statements.
Exactly. I mean, somebody said to me that they'd asked me to contact Larry on their behalf, and I hadn't. I mean, I don't remember that. If I had done, then I apologise, but I don't recall that at all.
Larry's easy enough to get hold of, isn't he, Ben?
Well, he's on Facebook. Yeah, you can just get, if you want to get hold of him on Facebook, he's quite easy to reach. You know, you can just, you don't need me to act as a go-between if you want to contact Larry. So this is the magazine, which is, I'll have to look through it. It's a pretty good magazine, I must say. It's, like I said, it's a new project, and I did enjoy, well, not that article, obviously, but I did enjoy some of the other material that's in the magazine. And they've got this new conference, and I was quite keen to go. I thought, great. So I got a ticket. It was only £10, really cheap. And then I was contacted by one of the organisers. And he wrote to me and said, basically, I noticed you're going along to the Outer Limits magazine. Are you aware that some of these people are going? And he mentioned a few people who were going. He mentioned three members of what I call the Larry Warren hate cult.
Okay.
Which I think is a good name for it. And he basically said, look, if you're going along and they're going along, I don't want any trouble. Okay, because I know the history between you guys. I know that you two, you've fallen out with them and they've fallen out with you. I don't want any trouble at all. I want none at all. And I suppose this is a legitimate concern. And I think if I was in his position, I would be worried too. Because, well, you've seen what's gone on between us.
Sure. Well, it's his first conference. I suppose he's going to be a little bit more nervous about it all being good.
Yeah, he's going to be nervous. He's going to be, and that's understandable. He doesn't want some big Barney breaking out in the middle of the auditorium. You don't want fisticuffs flying everywhere while someone's trying to enjoy the conference. So he was, as I said, he approached me and raised his concern. So I responded in good faith. I wrote back to him. I said, don't worry, I'll be as good as gold.
So you gave him assurances that there wouldn't be any problems from your side.
Yep, I gave him absolute assurances I would be at my best behaviour. Okay. I'd be on my best behaviour. I would not even interact with these people at all. And I'd already made a decision to do that anyway. I mean, I actually said in one of my articles, one of my previous articles in this series, I know a time is going to come when my paths are going to cross with these people. There's only four of them in this Larry Warren hate cult. I might be at the same conferences as them. I might even be on the stage with them. I might even share a stage with them. I may be emceeing an event which they're speaking at. If that's the case, I'm willing to behave in a professional, show the basic professional courtesy and deal with them for the sake of the spirit of the conference. I said I would deal with them. I'm happy to share. I'm not one of these people who's going to refuse to share a stage with somebody because I don't like them or because of this issue. If I mean, Alison Dunlop, Sasha Christie, they do live stage performances, and I would be willing to be at a conference with them. I'd be willing to MC an event where they were at. I'll just stick to the subject matter in hand, and I just grin and bear it. Put it that way. And I made this very clear. I actually said when I was going to probe, I thought that one of them might turn up. If we're both delegates at a conference, I'll just have to learn to stay out of their way, which I'm quite happy to do. And I'd already thought about this before when I first made the decision I wanted to go to this event in Hull. I said they're going to be there, Sasha's going to be there certainly, and probably the others will be there, so how will that be all right? And I thought, that's easy, I'll just sit on the other side of the room, I'll enjoy the conference, I won't interact with them at all, I won't look at them, I won't speak to them, just keep out of their way. And this is what I basically said to the organizer as in a few sentences. But I did say, and I thought it was fair enough, I said, look, I suggested that he contact, seeing as he'd gone out of his way to approach me on this matter, it seemed fair that he should perhaps do the same with them. And I suggested that he maybe contact them and explain the situation as he had to me, his concerns, and ask for a similar commitment.
Yep, and did he come back to you about your reassurances?
Well, this is the thing, you see. I mean, after I'd emailed him this, the next thing I know, they had an email informing me. It was a polite, respectful email, as polite and respectful as can be in this situation, that they sent me an email requesting that I do not attend. And this guy, he informed me that my ticket fee was being returned via PayPal, and it was.
So he said, sorry, so let's just get this straight. He sent you an email asking for your assurances. You replied giving your assurances.
Yeah.
And asking him further to contact the others.
Yeah.
In that process, at that same time, you then received another email saying that you'd already had your ticket refunded and you weren't really wanted there.
This is the very next email I got from him, was basically saying, I would not be admitted. I would not be admitted to the conferences. I was not welcome there. He said, this is not a personal slur against my character. He's got nothing against me personally. He regrets taking this action. He's just simply worried that good order would not be maintained with me and the Larry Warren hate cult in the same room. That's what he's, after I'd already reassured him there'd be no problems from my side. I was actually, what I was essentially doing was proposing an unconditional 24-hour ceasefire between myself and them. That's just Sasha, Allison, Dave, James. You know, I was just going to say, let's just have a 24-hour truce. It'd be like in the war. You know, we can get out the trenches. We can play a game of football if you like. I don't care. Let's just leave it. Just knock it on the head. Why? Because I wanted to enjoy the conference too, and I wanted everyone else to enjoy it.
Yeah.
And so the last thing I expected was, you know, after I responded in good faith to this guy. And I suggested this. I thought, well, he's going to go and talk to them, and they're probably going to agree because, you know, we all want to enjoy the conference together. So I responded this way. I mean, I was shocked. I mean, I was in the middle of doing Hapanmo Radio at the time, and I think you could even, if you listen to the show, it's program 232. You may even be able to pick out the tremor in my voice.
Well, I was listening to the show, and I've got to admit that you did seem slightly subdued at a certain point in the show.
It was just before the feature actually, when I knew I was going to have to talk, and I was, of course, I keep Facebook open while I'm on the radio because I post the show notices and things like that when they're going to go up. And this thing popped up in front of me, this email informing me that I was banned from the conference. And he asked me to understand, not to take it personally. And it's hard not to take it these things personally. You know, I sympathize with his position. I really do. I think, you know, he is in a difficult position. It doesn't mean that he can do the wrong thing, unfair and unpractical thing, and then expect me to keep silent about it and not say anything.
There seems to be a little bit of lack of balance here, because he's banned you. I take it he hasn't banned or stopped the others or refunded their tickets from coming then.
I doubt if he has. I mean, I don't know specifically, but I don't think so. Which there could be several reasons for this. Possibly because he knows that I won't hurl massive amounts of abuse at him on the internet if he bans me.
Yeah.
Whereas if he bans the others, they will. Yeah. So he says that the main reason is that because they purchased their tickets first. And so he said, I'm not going to take sides in this. It's just simple. They purchased their tickets first. So that means it's only fair that they should be allowed to stay. Now, that factor is, I don't think that should be a factor in this, because I mean, there's another factor we should take into consideration here in terms of just the simple fairness of the whole thing. Okay, I came in later, but then I'm the one who proposed that we simply that there'd be no trouble. I'm the one who's saying there's no trouble. Now, for him to respond this way, the only thing I can come up with, I mean, he didn't say specifically, but I mean, you can see it reading between the lines. Is he actually did contact the Larry One hate cult, and he said the same thing to them as he did to me, and they said, no way are we going to guarantee our good behavior if Ben Emlyn Jones is in that room. We can't. We will, even if it's like I said, I'm just going to sit there and enjoy the conference. They're basically saying, but we can't guarantee we will if he's there. I mean, I'll read out what I actually wrote to him. I've left out a few details of here just for confidentiality reasons, but I said this is what I said. I've edited this slightly, like I said. Of course, the last thing I want to do is put you in a difficult position, yet I must protest. It was you who first approached me regarding this issue and seeking reassurance. I guaranteed my good behavior on the day. I was hoping that Larry's enemies would then offer equal reassurances and all would go smoothly, and we could simply mutually agree to uphold a level of professional decorum. Don't you want this? If I'm willing to do that at my end and they are not at theirs, then why am I the one being excluded? Have those three said that they will cause trouble if I'm there? In which case, are they the kind of people you want at the event? Why am I the one getting the talking to and not them? I realize that this is not a personal slant against me. However, I'm being banned from a conference I really want to attend and hoped to enjoy when I've done nothing wrong. This is a purely personal dispute between me and them. It's not me who wants to spread it out and turn it into some major scandal. All I've done is disagree with these people and write my own online articles countering theirs. Therefore, I'd like to appeal. Please, could you reconsider? That was what I sent out. And this was 2 days before I I decided that obviously I didn't think he was going to get back to me.
So I went public with it. You wrote to him, and obviously you didn't get a reply for a couple of days.
Yeah.
Or any reply? Have you had a reply?
Nothing. I've had only since I published the article, because I decided, well, what am I going to do here? I mean,
right.
You know, I felt upset by this. I felt I'd been treated unjustly, and I thought that the reason I'd been treated this way is because of this campaign of terror that is going on in our community at the moment, and therefore I thought I have an obligation to let people know what's going on publicly.
Yep.
So I wrote a little article here explaining exactly what happened, and I'm making the points I've made here. It's sad. I mean, because I don't like getting into these conflicts with people. I don't like doing this. But
it's clearly left a bit of taste in your mouth.
Yeah, but and I said, like, I don't mean any personal. I don't feel any personal desire to condemn the organisers of this conference. Like I said, if you're going, I don't recommend you not go. A lot of people have stuck up for me, and a lot of people have said they appreciate what I'm doing. I mean, I've had a lot of feedback from this, which has been positive towards me mostly. People who are saying they do appreciate me, and they do understand, they do like, they enjoy my presence at their conferences. And they're baffled by what's going on here, and I really want to say thank you to everybody who's done that. I really do, because it means a hell of a lot. It's meant a hell of a lot, because I felt really, really, I did feel under attack when this happened. And so when people come to me and they remind me of how that they do appreciate me, then that means an awful lot in that situation. It's very, very important to me in that situation. So thank you very much to everyone who has replied. And don't be angry as such with these people. Just the thing to be angry about is this situation and the people who cause it at the root cause of this, which is this obsessive hate cult.
From the outside looking in, obviously, like you said, there's no need to be angry, but we are disheartened that this can happen and that you have been singled out. Where there was any balance, the same should have been applied to the other side.
Exactly.
But that put aside, this isn't the first time that this kind of thing's been happening lately. There's a couple of other conferences that I'm aware of that were due to have gone ahead this year and have been cancelled.
Yeah, one certain I know of.
Yeah, and there's another one that I'm aware of as well.
Yeah.
Again, because of the influence, should we say, from these certain individuals that we mentioned earlier this evening, something needs to be done because, you know, people's events are getting spoiled. Individuals like yourself are being banned for no good reason. I mean, what can we do? What can we do to stop these people having such an influence on people?
It's really extremely disturbing. This is why this is the latest in a development. I mean, as I said, I know of at least one meeting that has been cancelled as a result of this. It's been cancelled by these people, this Larry Warren hate cult, simply going online and attacking the organisers of the event, attacking people who've even bought tickets and said they're going to attend. This has caused at least one event to be cancelled, possibly two. I don't know all the details. I've been given some confidential information. I can't reveal the sources. But what this means is this is an act of ufological vandalism. This is terrorism. This is ufological terrorism. This is people who have a obsessive fixation on destroying Larry Warren. And they want that so much. They want nothing now except the destruction of Larry Warren. And in order to do that, they will carpet bomb the entire ufological community in order to achieve this if necessary. They'll nuke every UFO event going, if only it means they can destroy Larry Warren. Now, this is not the actions of rational thinking individuals with an objective gripe against a single individual. This is the actions of, and what I've said is a cult. I've said before, truth mobs are cults. I've even before all this broke out, I've written articles and I've said on my 2016 year, I did a radio show summarizing the year 2016, and I explained why I think truth mobs are cults, and they are. I mean, it's amazing that these are just four people, and not very impressive people either. They are. The word keyboard warrior has become a cliche, so I changed it to hashtag pugilists. A pugilist is a boxer, and I thought that was a little bit more original than keyboard warriors, but that is what they are. I was speaking the last time I was on the show about these threats I've received from somebody, and he's posted these threats online. But he hasn't.
Have you had any further comments from any of these individuals since this all came out today?
No, since he said these things to me, I've attended several events, which I have made publicly my my location. I've said beforehand where I'm going to be, when I'm going to be there. This gentleman, if he wanted to, could come and confront me face to face and carry out and try to envisage his what he suggests, and he's not taken up that opportunity. And this, what's depressing about this is that it feels a bit like I'm up here on the battlements with you, with a couple of other people who are challenging and are basically fighting back against this. And we're the only ones, and it feels lonely. There's a large number of people who could join us, and they're not. They are because, and as I was saying, we talked about the last time I was on, they're doing it because they're frightened, I think. They're frightened because they know they'll get the same treatment. People like me are examples that these people will set up to say, if you do what Ben did, you'll get this as well. And
so people are frightened to speak up or come forward or.
Yeah. These are people who say, talk about the truth embargo. They talk about the ET truth embargo, and they challenge the keepers of the ET. They want to resist the keepers of the ET truth embargo. But what chance do they have of doing that when they're frightened?
You can kind of understand it because when they've seen the shit that's been thrown at them, at people like you, they just want to get on with their lives. They don't need that grief in their lives.
It is but that does, tempting for them.
That does have the advantage to our friends on the other side, doesn't it?
It is tempting to. I understand why people do it. I mean, I've been had abuse at. You've had abuse. Radio show hosts who've had me or Larry on have had abuse. And of course, as we know, any events that host either of us have had abuse. And it's just easier to say, right, I'm staying out of this. I'm staying out of it. I don't want anything to do with it. Let's just do what they want. Let's just appease them, and hopefully they'll be quiet.
So what would your advice be to anyone that's planning to make a conference in the future? What advice could you give to the organizers?
I would say to them, please don't surrender to this kind of thing. I mean, I know it's difficult. I know that what you'll get if you're in a position like if you decide to host Larry or host me, there will be a lot of harsh criticism from you. This will involve attacks against you, attacks against people who are delegates who are going along. But please don't give up. I want there to be a situation where you'll be able to do this conference. You'll be able to carry out this conference with the knowledge that there'll be a large group of people who will back you up. And so I ask all the people who are keeping their mouths shut now to speak out. Because if enough people do it, then it spreads the risk. And if there could be... What I want is for the entire community to unite and resist. And then... Because whatever your opinions of Larry, okay? And I know Larry is not... He's not a flawless angel, and we've talked about this previously. Larry's been on this show, all right? I know that. But nothing he's said or done deserves this response. Nothing Larry's ever said or done to anyone comes close to deserving this response. The lies that have been told about him the abuse he's received and the hatred he's received, and others like me who are supporting him. So let's. I promise I'll anyone who stands up against this Larry Ward hate cult, I'll do everything I can to defend you. And I ask other people to help me. Let's stand together and let's beat this.
That's good words, Ben.
Yeah.
And maybe we can just finish off on one thing. Obviously, there's going to be a few of your friends that were looking forward to meeting you at Hull who haven't seen you for a while. Where can they catch you in terms of events that you'll be going to or maybe even speaking at in the coming
years? Well,
so they can catch
there's
up
lots.
With you there.
There's lots of other things I'm going to. I mean, so I know I was going to meet up with some of you guys in Hull. I'll be at other places where plenty of other places we can meet at. For instance, the UFO Truth magazine, which is like an anchor in the storm when it comes to this situation. It really is. I'll be speaking in September at the 16th and 17th of September at UFO Truth magazine, and several other events. There's a couple of. I'm speaking in a couple of weeks, actually, an event in Manchester. The details are on the Hopanamoy Voice blog. What's interesting, I mean, I want to bring up one more thing. It's quite amazing. The world moves in mysterious ways, I often find. And something very funny happened, actually, just after. I mean, I've posted this article about how upset about my feelings about what happened to me. Being banned from this conference, and I went to my email. I opened up my email, and there's a little email from a guy I know. He says, "Ben, this is for you." And there was an attachment. It was a PDF which I downloaded and opened, and it was an invitation to a wedding. It was his wedding.
Fantastic.
And guess what date it's going to be?
Let me guess. The 9th of September.
Correct. I mean, it's just you couldn't make it up.
Every cloud has a silver lining.
I mean, this is a guy. I mean, I knew they were getting married. This is a friend of my brother, actually, primarily, but he's invited both of us. I knew he was getting married. I knew he was getting married sometime this summer, but he hadn't selected a date yet, as far as I knew. But then he selected the date. He selected the date of the conference, and he decided to tell me. He must have posted the email just before I was writing this, and he knows nothing about this situation. So I mean, that's really quite an interesting bit of synchronicity there. So screw the conference. I wouldn't go now, even if they changed their minds. I'm going to this wedding now. I've already replied. I've RSVP'd to say yes, I'm going.
Yeah, that's good.
So that's what I'll do instead.
And you'll be around people that want you there, and family and friends, which is always good.
Unless there's another guest turns up, which the couple think I won't get on with, and then they might ask me not to attend. So.
Well, we can do another
knows?
Show about that one, Ben, if it happens.
But I won't be at the conference. I wouldn't go to the conference now, even if my invitation was renewed. I'll be swilling champagne in some nice little place. But if you do go, I hope you enjoy it. Don't, like I said, I mean, there's too much hatred in this community. I want to stay in the business. Stay as much as you can in the business of ufology. Go along to the conference, enjoy it. There's Malcolm Robinson speaking. There's plenty of other good speakers. It should be really interesting. Whether you agree or disagree with them, you'll learn an awful lot. So please do go along.
That's very magnanimous of you, Ben.
I want to be dignified about this. Like I said, I don't want to. Don't want to be bitter.
And you have been all the way through, definitely. Thanks. I think that's a good point to call it a night on. What do you think?
Yeah, thanks for having me on. Thanks for letting me talk about this again.
It was a pleasure, Ben. Absolute pleasure.
Okay,
my friend. We'll catch up soon.
Take it easy, Tino.
All the best, buddy. Bye for now.